Good evening, dear friends. I'd like to welcome you all for this third CMC Vellore COVID public lecture series. And as we had mentioned earlier, various topics which are relevant to the care and management of COVID patients, we have been trying to bring it out every week. And I hope the first two lectures have been useful. And we have also shared the video links of the first two lectures. Today's topic is on anticoagulation in COVID-19. And the speaker for today's topic is Dr. Bala Mugesh, who is a professor in the Department of Pulmonary Medicine. Bala Mugesh has several years of experience in the specialty, and he also has his heart for the missions, and we like to welcome Bala Mugesh to share his expertise with the audience and many of them who are there from the mission hospitals. This session will be moderated by Dr. Anand Zakaria, who's from the Department of Medicine, professor and a very senior faculty. Again, he has the passion for education, passion for reaching out to the missions. I'd like to invite Dr. Anand Zakaria to take over the session.
Welcome to the third Pulse lecture. The content of the Pulse lecture is to give an up-to-date review of key areas in the practice of COVID-19 care and to share it with the audience both in CMC Vellore, in the mission network across India and beyond that, and also to share the experience that we have in CMC as a way of influencing practice. I would request that all of you who are outside CMC Vellore, please write your name and the organization that you are part of in the chat box. I'd also request you to mute your mics and your videos for the benefit of others. Please type your questions as they come to you in the chat box, which we will address at the end of the talk today. So we're all in the middle of the epidemic and little concerned that things are becoming more. But on a positive note, I would like to say that the number of cases here this week, which are detected positive, has been less than the last week in CMC. And also the government has also changed their policy of admission of asymptomatic cases so that to allow for home isolation of younger people. Today we are exploring a new and evolving area of anticoagulation guidelines for COVID-19. I would like to preface the discussion by saying that I'm not aware of any other infectious disease for which there is an anticoagulation recommendation. So it is a new concept that an infectious disease can cause thrombosis. Today's presentation is an attempt to clear the confusion that exists. Is COVID-19 truly a prothrombotic disease? What is the risk? Should we be offering routine thromboprophylaxis? When should we be therapeutically anticoagulating? Should prophylaxis continue at discharge? To deliver this fairly challenging talk, we're really glad that Dr. Bala Mugesh, professor and head of pulmonary medicine, has agreed to take up the challenge for this evening. Following his lecture, we will have some sharing of experiences from CMC Vellore of an anticoagulation survey among faculty involved in COVID care, an anticoagulation audit in one unit of medicine, and a presentation of some cases of thrombosis in COVID-19. So I would like to hand over the stage to Bala for to deliver his talk today.
Good afternoon, friends. Thank you, Dr. Thomas Ram for that kind introduction, and Dr. Anand Sag for giving me this privilege of talking on anticoagulation in COVID-19. Alluded to, it is a challenging topic. We in CMC meet twice a week as clinical treatment group for COVID to discuss the latest literature, the evidences, and make recommendations for practice in CMC. And sometime back, this topic was taken up, anticoagulation in COVID-19. And that session went on for 3-4 weeks because there is so much of interesting debate, pro-con debate, as you would have seen in conferences. And there is new evidences coming up each week. And it is a very challenging and interesting topic. And whatever I am going to say today may be completely outdated by tomorrow or day after when new evidences, new literature comes on this topic. So I'll be going through the various aspects of anticoagulation, as Dr. Anand Sag already told. It is a field of emerging evidence. There are multiple schools of thought whether COVID-19 is a prothrombotic state or not. It is like the well-known example of multiple blind experts trying to describe a big elephant. So we don't know the whole gamut, the whole picture, but whatever evidences we do have till now, I will try to go through it step by step. The classical teaching of respiratory failure in any infectious disease, a viral illness, is it causes diffuse alveolar damage due to type 2 pneumocyte injury, and then that results in severe respiratory failure. But in addition to this mechanism, what is being increasingly recognized that there is direct damage by the virus to the pulmonary vascular endothelium, and this causes what is called thromboinflammation, microthrombosis, as well as inflammation at the smaller blood vessels, and this also contributes to respiratory failure in COVID-19. There is a small study which was done among the departments of units of medicine department as well as hepatology in CMC, which looked at reticuloendothelial activation in COVID-19 patients. And what they found out was that the marker of endothelial activation, von Willebrand factor, was significantly elevated in those people who had poor outcome, like who died. In addition to that, the marker of thrombin generation, D-dimer, was also significantly elevated. This has also been shown in multiple other studies that D-dimer is a marker of disease severity and poor outcome. So this shows that there is, of course, endothelial activation, which can contribute to the poor disease outcome in COVID-19. I'll go through a few studies which shows what's the incidence or prevalence of thromboembolism in COVID-19 patients. This study, which looked at 184 ICU patients with proven COVID-19 pneumonia, all patients were on prophylactic doses of anticoagulation. And they found out that CTPA proven or compression ultrasonography proven venous thromboembolism was found in 27%. That's quite high as compared to any other disease we know till now. And arterial thrombotic events were found in 3.7% of patients. Another observational study in nearly 200 hospitalized patients in COVID-19, all of them again were given routine thromboprophylaxis. And they found out that 42% of patients had any venous thromboembolism, and 25% of them, they were symptomatic. So that means that if you do only the symptom screening for venous thromboembolism, we will miss a significant number of patients with venous thromboembolism. And when they stratified according to those who required ICU care and those people in the ward, nearly 60% of those in ICU had evidence of venous thromboembolism as compared to 9.2% in wall. So when there are multiple evidences, what do? We do a systematic review and meta-analysis. So this looked at 17 studies involving nearly 2,000 hospitalized COVID-19 patients and found out that the incidence of venous thromboembolism is 25% in hospitalized patients. And more severe the category of illness, the more risk of venous thromboembolism, and prophylaxis is associated with lower incidence. So these are the clinical study. So do we have evidence from autopsy series or pathological studies? Yes, we do have. I'll just highlight a couple of them. This autopsy series on 11 patients, out of 10 of them have received prophylactic anticoagulation, and in none of them, venous thromboembolism were clinically suspected before the patient died. And they found out that there was unexpected thrombosis in small to medium-sized pulmonary arteries in all of them. And that is a very remarkable finding. Another study which looked at alveolar capillary microthrombi, they found out that COVID-19 patients, there are 9 times the alveolar capillary microthrombi are 9 times as prevalent as compared to influenza patients. So this is not purely that we are looking more, that's why we are finding more evidence of thrombosis. As compared to other similar viral illnesses like influenza, yes, there is definite more prevalence of venous thromboembolism as well as pulmonary arterial microthrombi in the smaller vessels. So the venous thromboembolism is more like an embolic phenomena which happens in the large and medium-sized pulmonary arteries, but the smaller vessels, there is thrombosis, and this is likely to be in situ thrombosis rather than an embolic phenomenon. So why do COVID-19 patients are predisposed to thrombosis? That's because all three aspects of the virtuous triad has been adversely affected by this infection. There is endothelial injury by direct coronavirus causing injury to the capillary endothelial cells. There is stasis of blood, not only by immobilization in hospitalized patient, but there is redistribution of pulmonary blood flow, and there is stasis in the pulmonary vascular bed. And there is a hypercoagulable state as evidenced by thromboelastography. So how to treat? So now we know that there is COVID-19 patients are more predisposed to thrombosis. How do we treat? Until now, there is no published randomized controlled trial to support that any intensity of anticoagulation is helpful. Most of the evidence is retrospective case series. And we can't sit quiet saying that I will wait for RCT to base my clinical treatment. We need to have a judgmental approach, careful, calculated approach to treat our patients till we have better evidence. And we need to also remember that absence of evidence of benefit is not evidence of absence of benefit. Also, we need to remember that first do no harm. No treatment is without harm, and we need to be aware of that. Another thing we need to remember that there is some evidence, although not proven in actual clinical practice, there is some evidence that heparin has an anti-inflammatory property. So not only that it is useful as an anticoagulant, there is increasing evidence that it inhibits the viral entry, it is an anti-inflammatory agent. And so there's some proposed that heparin should be considered rather than other oral anticoagulants because they don't have antiviral effects, but this is not yet proven by any clinical studies. So I'll just quickly glance through some of the observational studies which we have regarding anticoagulation. The first study is compares prophylactic heparin versus no anticoagulation in severe COVID patients. There was no difference in 28-day mortality, but The mortality was significantly lower in heparin users if there is sepsis-induced coagulopathy score of more than or equal to 4 and increased D-dimer level. So it definitely helped in sicker patients and those with increased D-dimer. The prophylactic heparin definitely caused reduced mortality. The second study compared standard dose low molecular weight heparin with intermediate dose. The standard dose is what we usually give, 40 milligram once daily, equivalent of enoxaparin. The intermediate dose is twice daily. You give the same 40 milligram twice daily. And they found out that their intermediate dose heparin causes lower in hospital all-cause mortality, 5.8% versus 18.8%. The third study looked in patients on mechanical ventilation, and they showed that therapeutic anticoagulation improved mortality, 63% versus 86.2%. And you all know mechanical ventilation has very high mortality in COVID-19 patients. And in such patients, there is some evidence that therapeutic anticoagulation is helpful. And the fourth study, they found out that as compared to no anticoagulation, both therapeutic and prophylactic anticoagulation reduces mortality with adjusted hazard ratio of hovering around 0.5. And when initiated within 2 days of admission, there is not much difference between therapeutic and prophylactic anticoagulation. Again, there are multiple other studies. I came across this meta-analysis of 8 studies involving nearly 3,000 patients, and they found out that prophylactic heparin in moderate to severe COVID-19 patients given does not have much mortality benefit, but in a subset of patients with moderate symptoms, with high D-dimer more than 3 microgram per liter and normal platelet and PT values, they have mortality benefit. So there is increasing evidence that there is the sicker the patients, and there is a subset of patients in which the prophylactic dose or a higher dose is beneficial. And all these are observational studies, a retrospective analysis of data. So what are the risks of anticoagulation in COVID-19 patients? Whatever clinical experience is, people say that they don't, COVID-19 patients, they don't bleed as compared to other patients with sepsis. They don't go into DIC with low platelets, and it's not very common. So however, the risk is there as compared to when we give therapeutic doses, the risk is almost twice as high as compared to prophylactic dose. And that has been shown that the risk is twofold higher as compared to the standard dose thromboprophylaxis. And we need to remember that, yes, there is bleeding risk when we intensify the anticoagulation. And another aspect which has been increasingly recognized is acquired heparin resistance. In COVID-19 patients, when we give anticoagulation with the heparin, it's been found out that they don't increase their anti-factor 10A levels as they should normally. And in this study of severely ill patients in intensive treatment unit, 95% of them failed to achieve the target anti-10A levels, as compared to 27% of ward patients. And some authorities say that, yes, we may need to monitor the anti-10A levels when we are giving low molecular weight heparin. And that's the logic of increasing the dose of prophylactic or giving intermediate dose thromboprophylaxis in COVID-19 patients. And a word about monitoring as well. When I spoke to Dr. Sukesh of Department of Blood Transfusion, and he suggested that the anti-10A level, we have to be very careful that the sample reaches the lab and the sample is analyzed within 30 minutes to 1 hour. So if you delay it, the anti-10A levels is not going to be reliable. So monitoring is easier said, but you need to really gear up to transport the specimen and analyze it very quickly. Also, both of them, anti-10A as well as APTT, if you are doing giving heparin, are prone to monitoring inaccuracies in COVID-19 patients, because the assay can be altered by variations in fibrinogen, antiphospholipid antibodies, and factor 8 levels, which are frequently found in COVID-19 patients. So we have to be aware of inadequacies of monitoring the effect of anticoagulation as well. What's the role of aspirin in thromboprophylaxis? Aspirin has no role in non-COVID medical illness as prevention of venous thromboembolism. However, this is a study which showed that what's the role of aspirin as compared to other anticoagulation in secondary prevention of venous thromboembolism, it's no role, the confidence interval is crossing one. However, we know that COVID-19 patients are more prone to develop not only venous thromboembolism, arterial thromboembolism, stroke, coronary artery disease, and the peripheral limb ischemia. So is there a role for aspirin? There is no studies yet to say that aspirin has a role. Also, the pulmonary artery microthrombi in the small vessels, they are rich in platelets. So anticoagulation may not have an effect in the microthrombi. Aspirin, does it have a low? Theoretically, yes, but we don't have evidence yet that we can give aspirin and that improves the outcome. So what should we do till we get further evidences? Numerous institutions and others have their own protocol, but none have been prospectively proven. And basically, there are three different categories or three of guidelines or protocols which has been described. One is conservative, liberal anticoagulation, and aggressive anticoagulation. And we in CMC, all three have been described in CMC. I will go through each one of them. In the CMC handbook, which was published, it can be considered as a conservative anticoagulation, which says that asymptomatic infection, mild infection, anticoagulation may be administered if they have at least one risk factor for venous thromboembolism. Yes, that is very appropriate. Now that we have started home isolation, we can't expect people at home to take anticoagulation and then monitor the side effects. So this is non-controversial that asymptomatic mild infection anticoagulation need not be routinely given. If they have risk factors, yes, we need to give. Moderate, severe, or critical COVID-19 have been advised prophylactic anticoagulation. And therapeutic dose anticoagulation may be given if there is clinical suspicion of DVT, pulmonary thromboembolism, either proven or just suspected. You can't do imaging, but you strongly suspect, you can give therapeutic anticoagulation. In the CMC COVID clinical treatment group, I would describe this as a more liberal strategy, where the mild and moderate category is almost similar to the conservative strategy. The prophylactic dose only in those with mild COVID, only if there are risk factors. And in moderate COVID disease, prophylactic dose anticoagulation is recommended, and therapeutic anticoagulation if thromboembolism is suspected. In those with severe COVID illness, that is, they have high respiratory rate, saturation less than 90 recurring oxygen, you have to give prophylactic dose anticoagulation, and you can give intermediate dose anticoagulation if risk factors for thrombotic disease are present and or D-dimer is more than 1,500 nanograms per ml. That is three times the normal, more than three times the normal. So what we suggested is that you need to do a baseline D-dimer value, and if there is clinical deterioration, you need to repeat it. No need to routinely repeat it, but if there is clinical deterioration, you do repeat a D-dimer value. And if it is more than three times the upper limit of normal, you need to give intermediate dose anticoagulation in severe category. In those with critical COVID-19, ARDS, septic shock, you start with intermediate dose anticoagulation, and therapeutic dose anticoagulation if risk factors for thrombotic disease are present, or if there is thromboembolism is strongly suspected, like there is hemodynamic compromise, or there is a respiratory compromise, or the oxygen requirement is more than what you expect for the severity of pneumonia based on the imaging, chest X-ray, you feel that it is out of proportion to the chest X-ray findings, then you can give therapeutic dose anticoagulation. And the risk factors for thrombotic disease, age equal to or more than 60, dehydration, active cancer, and these are all well described. And significantly reduced mobility from baseline, likely to persist for more than or equal to 3 days, is suggested as one of the risk factors. But we have to be aware that all severely ill COVID-19 patients on oxygen, this will automatically become a risk factor. In our medical ICU, they have a little more aggressive approach where severe patients with severe COVID and critical COVID are managed. A baseline coagulation pattern parameters are checked, and if the D-dimer is more than 1,000, and they go into the high-risk category along with the risk factors which I just mentioned. And only if all of them are negative, they consider it as lower risk and prophylactic or intermediate dose anticoagulation is given. Otherwise, you give high dose or therapeutic anticoagulation. And the adequacy of anticoagulation is confirmed by monitoring anti-factor 10A levels. And if there is clinical worsening like refractory hypoxia, increasing ventilatory requirements with a rising D-dimer, or new onset of VTE while on therapeutic anticoagulation, there is an option of considering antiplatelets, aspirin loading dose followed by low dose aspirin, and even thrombolysis with alteplase. So this is a more aggressive approach in the severest of severe COVID-19 patients. Also, we need to be aware that the standard dose of 40 milligram once daily for prophylactic anticoagulation may not be sufficient for people who are obese. So for obese patient, we may need to use formula of 0.5 milligram per kg body weight as the prophylactic dose. So what's the role of post-discharge anticoagulation? Again, for all medical illness, it's not a standard of care to give anticoagulation after discharge in non-COVID medical diseases. And it has been proven by trials that although it prevents venous thromboembolism after discharge, there is high chance of bleeding, so it is not the standard of care. But what about COVID-19? Are they at higher risk of venous thromboembolism after discharge? This study looked at the evidence for venous thromboembolism after discharge. This is done in London, two hospitals in London, where they accumulated data of all venous thromboembolism in that geographical area over a period of time. And it was during the time of lockdown, so the people, it's unlikely that they would have moved to some other place. And they found out that the incidence of venous thromboembolism post-discharge within 42 days is not much difference between COVID-19 patients and a similar group which was done last year, non-COVID discharges. So they concluded that rate of post-discharge hospital-associated venous thromboembolism following hospitalization is low. It's not significantly high. So routine post-discharge thromboprophylaxis is not required. And again, another study which looked at 163 patients discharged after COVID-19, and they were not given anticoagulation, they found out that the venous thromboembolism prevalence is 0.6%, which is not high as compared to the non-COVID medical illness. But the overall thrombosis incidence, arterial and venous, was 2.5%. That is significant. But the bleeding, even without taking anticoagulation was also significant, 3.7% after discharge from hospitalization. So what should we do? Is there a role of post-discharge anticoagulation? And during last couple of months, this study was published, which is a sub-analysis of a Mariner trial, which looked at post-discharge prophylaxis with rivaroxaban. And when they looked at a subgroup with high risk factors, like they used a score called Improve Venous Thromboembolism Risk Score, along with a D-dimer value at discharge of more than twice the upper limit of normal, when they combined these two factors and they found out that there is a 28% reduction in fatal and major arterial and venous thromboembolism. So there is some evidence that if you look at not only at venous but arterial thrombosis, there is some evidence that in those with high risk factors and high D-dimer values, there may be a role. And there is no increased risk of bleeding. Okay, rivaroxaban is costly, it has high chance of bleeding. What about aspirin? Again, there is a subgroup analysis of the same trial, which looked at people who have been taking aspirin for other indications, for primary prevention or secondary prevention of stroke or coronary artery disease. And they found out that aspirin is as good as rivaroxaban. So these are not in COVID patients, these are in non-COVID illness. So what do we do? So we have to base our decisions on a case-by-case basis. If the patient has been started on a therapeutic dose anticoagulation, thinking that patient has pulmonary thrombosis or embolism in hospital, how long to give anticoagulation is a question. If CTPA can be done once the patient is stable, his oxygen requirement has come down, he can be shifted safely to CT scan for a CT angio, then that is the best option. You can do a CTPA at that point of time. If thrombosis is confirmed, there is no doubt you have to give anticoagulation for at least 3 months. But what if it cannot be done? Is there a role of D-dimer at discharge if it is high? And as well as there are additional risk factors, can we give post-discharge anticoagulation? It's a question open for our discretion. Yes, we need to carefully assess such patients for bleeding risk as well as the risk for recurrence of thromboembolism, and we have to remember the cost involved in doing whatever things which we are doing. If it is D-dimer or CTPA, we are giving rivaroxaban, we have to be aware of the cost involved and the risk of bleeding which is involved. So in conclusion, I would like to quote from the Holy Bible, for the life of a creature is in the blood. And this is especially very important when we are dealing with patients with COVID-19. We have to be aware of the circulatory system as well. Arterial and venous thrombosis, they are common in COVID-19. And we need to carefully consider anticoagulation in moderate to severe category, because these are the people who are at higher risk of mortality. If therapeutic anticoagulation has been started with the clinical suspicion of pulmonary thromboembolism, then an individualized decision has to be taken how long we need to give the anticoagulation. Role of aspirin, it's not yet proven by any clinical studies, but there may be a role and we need to consider that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bala, for that very comprehensive presentation. Please type in your questions as so that we'll come back to them at the end of the session. We have three short presentations. The first is by Dr. Anna Wilson, who is faculty in the Department of Nephrology, on an anticoagulation survey among faculty at CMC. This will be followed by an anticoagulation audit in Medicine Unit 1 presented by Dr. Jim and Dr. Jennifer, postgraduates in the Department of Medicine, followed by a short presentation of cases of venous and arterial thrombosis from Medicine Unit 1 by Dr. Sumi, Dr. Susan, and Dr. Ittiara. Over to Anna.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'll be presenting the results of a survey on anticoagulation practice, which was carried out on behalf of the CCC training desk, mainly with a view to obtain a snapshot of current opinions among consultants on anticoagulation practice and to determine areas where there was a significant variation practice, where further guidelines or guidance would be required. So who took the survey? Around 64 consultants took the time to answer the survey. They were mostly at the assistant professor of physician level, and the majority were male. And these were mainly consultants who had experience of working in level one and level two wards. A very small minority actually had worked in the ICU. And a little over half had completed our online module on the clinical management of COVID-19. For the purposes of this survey, we defined prophylactic anticoagulation, intermediate anticoagulation, and therapeutic anticoagulation, as shown on the slide. We asked participants to tell us if they had any alternate dosage for these particular categories. And one participant said that they defined prophylactic anticoagulation as enoxaparin 1 mg per kg once daily, and therapeutic as 1 mg per kg twice daily. So the first question was what the preferred anticoagulation agent was, and the majority, vast majority, reported this to be enoxaparin. Right. The next question was on the utility of D-dimer. And the responses ranged from strong disagreement to strong agreement. We clubbed the responses which were along the disagreement side of the spectrum, and those are on the agreement side of the spectrum, and these are what are shown in red and blue respectively. So for the first question, do you think a baseline D-dimer should be sent for all patients? Generally, people tended to agree with this statement. In contrast to this, the next question asked, should a baseline D-dimer be sent only for those with moderate and critical patients? And consistent with the findings of the first question, people felt no, it should not be sent only for those with moderate and critical patients. The third question was, when a patient deteriorates, do you routinely order a D-dimer? And there was consensus towards ordering a D-dimer in such cases. When it came to routinely ordering a D-dimer every 48 to 72 hours in severe and critical patients, there was a lot less agreement with this practice. There was also a lot of divided opinion regarding what to do when an increasing trend of D-dimer was seen. So this, it was all along this spectrum, no clear consensus. We then asked what they would do in various situations. This had to do with the severity of COVID, the D-dimer levels, and the presence or absence of risk factors for venous thromboembolism. So mild COVID, no risk factors for venous thromboembolism. Majority said they would offer no anticoagulation. Mild COVID with risk factors, majority said they would offer prophylactic anticoagulation. Mild COVID with the elevated D-dimer, no other risk factors. Again, there was a consensus towards prophylactic anticoagulation. Now on the moderate end of the spectrum, no risk factors. Again, more towards prophylactic anticoagulation. As we move towards moderate COVID with either risk factors for thromboembolism or a high D-dimer, there was more of a trend towards enhanced anticoagulation, either intermediate or therapeutic. And once we moved to the severe or critical end of the spectrum, clearly people were moving towards a therapeutic form of anticoagulation, which are what is shown in these figures. And as well as those who had a sudden respiratory or hemodynamic compromise, again, there was a tendency towards therapeutic anticoagulation. Most people tended to continue anticoagulation till discharge, and those in whom it had been started. However, not many people believed in post-discharge thromboprophylaxis in those who had received anticoagulation in hospital. So to summarize the findings, anticoagulation in COVID-19 is an evolving area, but there seems to be ambiguity in some of the finer details. The general consensus among the consultants is that there's a need for D-dimer testing at baseline and when patients deteriorate. Routine prophylactic anticoagulation in mild COVID with risk factors for thromboembolism, moderate COVID without risk factors for thromboembolism, and more of an intermediate or therapeutic anticoagulation in moderate COVID with risk factors for thromboembolism and severe and critical COVID. The implications of this survey are, of course, that we need to educate physicians with more information and evidence in this area, and this lecture was its main aim was actually to achieve this purpose and to also now document what we are doing and study the outcomes related to the various anticoagulation strategies being followed. Thank you for your patient listening. We'll now proceed with the audit on anticoagulation practice in Medicine One.
Good evening, everyone. I'm presenting on the anticoagulation audit that was done in COVID-19 patients admitted to the Medicine Unit One. So what we looked at was the practice of anticoagulation in Medicine One in COVID-19 patients. The specific questions that we looked at were the proportion of mild severity patients with risk factors for venous thromboembolism who received prophylactic anticoagulation, the proportion of specific WHO clinical categories who received prophylactic, intermediate or therapeutic anticoagulation, the choice and the duration of anticoagulant used, and if there are any minor or major bleeds associated with anticoagulation. So we looked at 97 patients out of three patients admitted in the period of July 15th to August 15th, admitted to various levels for COVID care under Medicine Unit 1. And we correlated the WHO clinical severity, the risk factors, and the use of anticoagulation among these patients. So as we already have seen, checked with the anticoagulation recommendation practice in a hospital with each category for our patients. So here we found out that for nearly 40 to 50 patients in all categories, mild, moderate, severe and critical, had at least one of the risk factors for venous thromboembolism, and predominantly the risk factors that was there was the age, that is more than 60. The other risk factors that was found was active cancer and a previous thrombotic disease overall, which was there in 7.2%. In mild disease it was 10.9%, and in critical disease it was 5.5%. So two specific questions that we saw was what proportion of mild severity with the risk factors for venous thromboembolism received a prophylactic anticoagulation according to the guidelines. So only 54%, that is 12 out of 22 patients who had risk factors received a prophylactic anticoagulation as given in the guidelines. But we also saw that the proportion of mild severity patients with no risk factors for venous thromboembolism, who received a prophylactic anticoagulation was 12.1, which is not recommended as per the guidelines practiced in our hospital. So here we found out that only 100% of patients in moderate illness received at least a prophylactic anticoagulation, and 41% of severe illness were on either intermediate or therapeutic anticoagulation. And nearly 88% of critical illness category received either intermediate or therapeutic anticoagulation. The patients who received at least initially prophylactic anticoagulation was further shifted to either intermediate or therapeutic based on clinical suspicion of either an embolic phenomenon or a high D-dimer value. We bring to notice of four patients in critical illness who never received any intermediate or therapeutic anticoagulation. These patients, three of them, they had received prophylactic dosage of either heparin or clexane, and on out of which one patient had a high D-dimer value, that is 4002. However, there was no contraindication that was against to use of therapeutic or intermediate anticoagulation. We also found that five patients with severe illness category, they received intermediate or therapeutic anticoagulation, out of which three were based on risk factors for thrombotic disease, But two out of them were unclear reasons. There was no clear evidence of embolism or clinical suspicion that was documented. So the choice of anticoagulation that was found would be enoxaparin in both prophylactic and therapeutic anticoagulation. We looked at the duration of the anticoagulation. In prophylactic anticoagulation, it was nearly 7 days, just nearly to the time period that a patient with mild severity was admitted in the hospital. And in therapeutic anticoagulation, it was nearly 12.5 days, ranging from 2 days to 24 days based on the recovery of the patient. We also found that there was only one patient who had a minor bleeding that was with associated with therapeutic anticoagulation, and there were no bleeding associated with prophylactic anticoagulation among the 44 patients, and the minor bleeding was a hematuria which did not require any sort of transfusion or intervention. Request Jennifer to conclude the slides on ADIP.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer from the Department of Medicine 1, and I would just like to highlight the points that we learned from the audit that we conducted on the practice of anticoagulation in COVID-19 patients admitted under Medicine 1. So from the audit that we conducted, we noted that there was good adherence to current anticoagulation treatment guidelines in the patients with moderate, severe, and critical COVID-19 according to the WHO severity criteria. So we need to carefully assess risk factors, especially in patients with mild disease, and appropriate anticoagulation strategies for the same. Patients with critical illness for best ward care should also be considered for therapeutic anticoagulation. And from our audit, we noted that enoxaparin is a preferred anticoagulant used in all categories of patients, and the risk of bleeding was actually low with both prophylactic and therapeutic anticoagulation. Therefore, there is continued need for orientation of all medical staff to the anticoagulation guidelines and the need for documentation of outcomes with different anticoagulation strategies. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to present on our clinical experience in Medicine 1 in dealing with arterial and venous thrombosis among COVID-19 patients. I think all the literature regarding the same has been covered by Dr. Bharat before. So we would like to highlight our cases. First, coming to venous thrombosis, I would like to discuss about two cases. First is a 65-year-old lady, a known hypertensive, who had come to a casualty with a moderate ARDS, diagnosed with a critical COVID, and was admitted and was getting treatment with oxygen therapy, anticoagulation, empirical antibiotics, and low-dose steroids. On day 12 of her admission, she developed left leg unilateral swelling and was diagnosed with a DVT. She had risk factors of age and immobilization in her, but despite adequate anticoagulation, she had developed the DVT. She continued to be in her ward, requiring 10 liters of O2. After 24 days in COVID ward, she was shifted to general ward, following which she was discharged home for long-term oxygen therapy with 10 liters O2. She passed away at home after 2 days. Second is a 72-year-old lady with multiple comorbidities who also had presented to our ED with complaints of severe ARDS and was diagnosed with critical COVID. She was admitted in an ICU for invasive ventilation and was also started on antibiotics, anticoagulation, low-dose steroids, and remdesivir. She was improving. Her oxygen requirements were slowly weaned off, and she was shifted out of ICU by day 12 and was in a level 2 wards. Her oxygen requirements came down. She was completely weaned off oxygen, shifted to general ward by day 24. On day 30 in general ward, when she was on adequate anticoagulation, she developed a left leg swelling, which was diagnosed again as a DVT. Her risk factors for venous thrombosis were elderly age, immobilization, previous history of DVT pulmonary embolism, and history of CA cervix in the past. Currently, she is off O2, admitted, undergoing rehabilitation. From these two cases, we see two patterns of incidence of venous thrombosis among our patients. First patient is someone who has been on therapeutic anticoagulation during the acute phase of infection, developed a DVT on day 12. While the second patient was someone who had a critical disease, after recovering from the disease while in the ward, had developed a DVT on day 30. So what we have observed from these two cases is the incidence of venous thrombosis despite therapeutic anticoagulation is present in both the cases. Second is the occurrence of thrombosis in our second patient, which was around day 30. There is evidence of literature evidence of increase in cumulative incidence among COVID patients, among mainly severe and critical COVID patients of venous thrombosis. The last thing I would like to highlight is these are the only two patients in our Department of Medicine 1 over the past 6 months who were diagnosed with a venous thrombosis. This is significantly decreased occurrence compared to what has been studied in the global evidence. So the question arises, are we underdiagnosing or underscreening our patients?
Now let's look into some of the cases which highlights the relationship between COVID and stroke. So here I present case one, which is that of a 75-year-old gentleman who came with COVID. He had comorbidities of diabetes and hypertension. On examination in casualty, he was hypoxic and tachypneic with severe ARDS, a PF of 93. So this is the first, this is the day one X-ray where we see bilateral infiltrates. By day six, they noticed him to have acute onset right-sided hemiparesis with sudden drop in sensorium. A CT brain was done, which showed acute left cerebellar infarct. This is the CT finding. This gentleman eventually went on to have worsening hypoxia and breathlessness. He was treated with antibiotics, therapeutic anticoagulation, antiplatelet agents, and statins. As we look at the day 12 X-ray, we see worsening respiratory, worsening COVID pneumonia. He eventually succumbed to his illness on day 12. Here, the cause of death was severe type 1 respiratory failure with hypoxic arrest, secondary to severe COVID pneumonia, contributing factor being a cerebrovascular accident. Case 2 is that of a 40-year-old gentleman with no comorbidities. Who presented with acute onset left-sided weakness, upper limb and lower limb weakness, with inability to speak for 1 day. On examination, he did not have any respiratory distress. He was maintaining good saturation in room air. A CT brain was done, which showed a large acute right MCA infarct with mass effect and midline shift. He was planned for a decompression surgery by neurosurgery as a part of a pre-operative screening. A COVID RT-PCR was done, which was positive. In view of poor prognosis, the surgery was withheld and he was taken up in level 2 care. By day 5, he developed respiratory distress requiring high oxygen requirements. Eventually, he had worsening of his hypoxia. As we see, this is the X-ray on day 1, and by day 5 he developed a new patch. So by day 5 he succumbed to his illness. Now here the cause of death is malignant MCA infarct with COVID-19 pneumonia and severe ARDS. Now these two cases highlight two different patterns. The first one being a patient who presented with severe COVID-19 infection, who had risk factors and went on to develop a stroke, which highlights the possible pathogenesis of infectious nature of COVID-19 coupled with risk factors predisposing patients with risk factors to develop a stroke. While the second case highlights a patient with no comorbidities, a young patient with no comorbidities who presented with COVID as well as a stroke simultaneously, leading us to question a possible hypothesis of can COVID cause severe arterial thrombosis in patients with no risk factor.
Good evening, I am Dr. Susan from the Department of Medicine 1. There have been reports from all over the world highlighting that when COVID-19 occurs in a patient who has risk factors for the development of coronary artery disease, there is an increased chance for the occurrence of an ischemic coronary event. And also the outcome is adverse and there is increased mortality when the two occur together. In this light, I would like to highlight three patients that we managed in our Department of Medicine 1. The first is a 72-year-old gentleman with definite risk factors for an ischemic coronary disease. And he came in with a severe COVID pneumonia. He had developed an NSTEMI during the course of his stay in hospital. He was medically managed. He was detected to have high D-dimers of 6,000. He was discharged after 2 weeks and advised follow-up with angioplasty at a later date. The second is a middle-aged gentleman who had absolutely no risk factors for ischemic cardiac disease. He had been diagnosed to have an ST elevation MI. He had been incidentally detected to have a COVID-19 illness. He was medically managed with thrombolysis, and he, while in hospital, had developed a cerebrovascular accident involving a major intracerebral vessel, and on the family's advice, he was discharged at request. The third is a 68-year-old gentleman, again with definite risk factors, who had presented with an ST elevation MI. He was detected to have mild COVID illness incidentally. He also had developed a cerebrovascular accident while in hospital involving a major intracerebral vessel. He succumbed to his illness, unfortunately. The first case highlights a particular pattern where in the time frame, it is a patient who had come in with COVID-19 illness and developed an ST elevation, a non-ST elevation MI during the course of stay in hospital. So this highlights the possibility that the pathogenesis here is the infection, acute infection itself, causing a plaque destabilization in a predisposed individual, or the prothrombotic milieu caused by the COVID-19 illness itself might have caused the occurrence. The next two cases, case 2 and case 3, highlight a specific second pattern which caused us to think whether asymptomatic or symptomatic COVID can lead to a prothrombotic state causing the association of an MI and a major stroke in the same individual. To summarize the findings in our three presentations, first is initially we looked at two cases which highlighted the occurrence of DVT while a patient was on therapeutic anticoagulation through the course of hospitalization. The second is that we had patients who had risk factors for arterial thrombosis who had presented with severe COVID illness. They had arterial thrombotic events in hospital. This mechanism coming into play here might be a plaque destabilization caused by the acute illness. The third fact that we would like to highlight is that we also had patients who had absolutely no risk factors who presented with a stroke or a myocardial infarction, and they had been concurrently diagnosed to have COVID-19 illness during their hospital stay. So here, the probable mechanism would be a COVID-19 induced in situ thrombosis due to the prothrombotic state. The above cases, which we have highlighted in our unit, seem to suggest a possible causal association between COVID-19 and the occurrence of arterial and venous thrombosis. The practice points for all of us would be, one, that doctors taking care of COVID-19 patients must be aware of the association between COVID-19 and arterial and venous thrombosis. Second, there is a higher morbidity and adverse outcome when there is COVID-19 infection associated with venous or arterial thrombosis. And third, we should have high index of suspicion for the diagnosis of venous thrombosis in patients with COVID-19
during the entire course of hospitalization and follow-up as well. Thank you.
Thank you to all the presenters, and we have a whole list of discussions, questions that have been posed. So I'm going to put the first questions to our MD students. The question is from Barney. Was the first case who developed stroke on anticoagulation prior to stroke? This question is to Dr. Sumi. Go ahead, you can answer.
Yes, the patient was on anticoagulation, therapeutic anticoagulation when he had come with COVID, critical COVID pneumonia.
The other question is to Jim or Jennifer. Was the patient who developed minor bleeding in the mild, moderate or severe category? Patient who developed bleeding was in the mild, moderate or severe category?
The patient was in the critical category. However, initially had received prophylactic anticoagulation for a period of 7 days with heparin, unfractionated heparin. And subsequently, she had developed DVT, which was presented by Dr. Tiara. And the anticoagulation was changed to therapeutic anticoagulation. And the therapeutic anticoagulation, on the third day, she had developed a significant hematuria. However, there was no significant hemoglobin drop. And the anticoagulation was changed to intermediate anticoagulation for a period of 2 to 3 days, and then subsequently increased back to therapeutic anticoagulation, and then they had rinsed with oral anticoagulation with warfarin, and subsequently she had been discharged on warfarin.
Thank you. So there are a whole lot of questions to Dr. Balamukesh, and we'll go one by one on these. So there's a question of the relationship between, sorry, I'm just having difficulty in going up and down. So the question is from Roshin. Is D-dimer the way to attribute hypoxia in a patient to thrombotic pulmonary capillaries other than ARDS? So what is the relationship between D-dimer and hypoxemia? So when the D-dimer goes up, does that indicate that there is thrombosis and that is contributing to hypoxemia? That is the question.
D-dimer is a marker of disease severity in COVID-19. So it's a non-specific inflammatory response. So a raised D-dimer doesn't always mean that you have thrombus or embolism. It just suggests that there is inflammation, significant amount of inflammation, and studies have shown that raised D-dimer correlates with worse outcome. So regarding the question that whether D-dimer means that there is thrombosis, doesn't always mean that, but raised D-dimer says that the patient is likely to have worse outcome and they are more likely to have thrombosis. So that's the way we need to look at D-dimer. So that's why we should not blindly believe that, okay, raised D-dimer, I need to give treatment irrespective of the disease severity. In the mild category of illness or an asymptomatic patient, you find out that baseline D-dimer is high, we need not jump and treat. You need to see the disease severity as well.
So D-dimer is a marker of thrombin generation. It's not a marker of thrombosis. So we shouldn't necessarily infer from a high D-dimer that thrombosis is happening, but it indicates that more thrombin is being generated. The other question also from Roshin is, would the use of steroids have an additional effect in reducing risk of thromboembolism through its anti-inflammatory effect?
Yeah, that's a very interesting hypothesis. Steroids have been definitely proven to improve the outcome, decreases the mortality in patients who require severe enough to require oxygen, critically ill or severe COVID patients. So how the steroids affect? There is a, Roshin has put forward a hypothesis that may be true, but we don't know yet how the steroids improve the mortality in COVID-19.
So in the studies which showed symptomatic thromboembolic events that you presented, were risk factors other than traditional risk factors for thrombotic events seen?
Whatever risk factors they have looked at is the standard risk factors, age and BMI and immobility and estrogen use. I am not aware of any other risk factors other than what has been traditionally explained. But COVID-19 per se is a risk factor in addition to the usual risk factor.
So I'm going to leave Bala for a moment. Is Sushil there? Sushil Selvaraj? Sushil is a faculty in hematology. I'm going to pose some of the questions in relation to anticoagulation to him. And there's a question, Sushil, which is from also from Roshin. I'm a CMC alumni working in rural hospital Assam. We've just started admitting COVID patients. Cost is an issue. So she's asking the question, while using plain heparin, what is the intermediate and therapeutic dosage?
Hi, Roshin, so actually this question is a little more layered than just the standard. Well, I'll give the advice. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yes, sir. So the standard doses that we would say would be, if we want to take it just as if the patient is say 50 to 60 kilos, 5,000 units subcute BD for prophylaxis. There's no concept of intermediate dose in unfractionated heparin, but we use a term called moderate dose. And that moderate dose is actually when we use fixed doses, we use 5,000 units Q12H initially and titrate the dose upwards based on an anti-10A level targeting 0.1 to 0.3. Of course, the therapeutic dose of unfractionated heparin would be targeting an APTT mid-interval APTT between 60 to 80. Now, obviously, I don't expect anti-10A levels to be done in the in peripheral hospitals. So more useful maybe a way to go about it would be taking unfractionated heparin 200 units per kilogram per 24 hours as the prophylactic dose, 500 units per kilogram per 24 hours as the intermediate dose, and the therapeutic dose, just like how we give for like pulmonary embolism, massive pulmonary embolism, heparin infusions. Sir, I just want to state here that the use of unfractionated heparin in all society guidelines has been is actually there's a advice to avoid it in preference to low molecular weight and fondaparinux for two very good reasons. One, if you use low molecular weight heparin, you can get away with the just with the caregiver going to the patient only twice in the day. So the exposure of the caregiver is decreased while using low molecular weight. And the other very important thing is the development of HIT, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, where, as we know, HIT is a very, very prothrombotic condition. And if this develops while the patient is having COVID, which is already a prothrombotic state, may further compromise the illness. So at the outset, while I've given the doses, I want to say that we would still recommend, if possible, using of low molecular weight heparin or fondaparinux at standard doses, 2.5 mg per 24 hours.
Thank you, Sushil. Do you have any comments on what would be feasible monitoring if you don't have APT or APTT? What would be a sensible way in which to approach the monitoring? Because the cost is there and availability both are factors in rural hospitals. So, and since many people are here on the call today, do you have any suggestions for them?
So, if we are targeting therapeutic anticoagulation, it is very difficult to do therapeutic anticoagulation with unfractionated heparin, especially if we don't have at least an APTT. An APTT target of 60 to 80 seconds would be ideally what we target with the therapeutic anticoagulation unfractionated. Now, there is more and more data. I think even Dr. Bala had shown a slide where we saw the incidence of heparin resistance, especially in the critically ill patients. So even usage of low molecular weight heparin, there is now society recommendation that we target anti-10A levels. Even when using therapeutic dose anticoagulation, which is 1 mg per kg, subcute twice a day. But I suppose, I mean, that is not a recommendation over the board, especially the country-wise guidelines don't have targeting of factor 10A level. So I suppose if we are targeting therapeutic and we don't have any way to check the adequacy, we should give low molecular weight heparin at 1 mg/kg BD. And if there is any ongoing thrombosis, including catheter thrombosis or any suspicion of further of lung pulmonary embolism, even if we cannot ship the patient for a CT, we should consider going up on the dose of low molecular weight heparin empirically.
So I think this question is both to Sushil and to Bala. What is the risk of bleeding with intermediate and therapeutic dosage? And is it different in different symptom categories, severity? I'll first put it to Bala.
Yeah, there is increased risk of bleeding, but the bleeding risk in general in COVID-19 patients is less as comparison to other sepsis patients, non-COVID sepsis patients. But evidence is that there is increased risk.
Any comments, Sushil?
There were two big cohorts followed up in blood. And both essentially showed bleeding risks in the severe cohort of around 5%. Anywhere between 0.5 to 5% is what they said. So most of the studies showing 3% risk in the critically ill group. But in the group on prophylaxis, prophylactic anticoagulation, they actually found 1.7 as the risk in prophylaxis. Whereas the group that did not have any anticoagulation, they found the risk to be 1.9. So it was actually a slightly lower, though it wasn't statistically significant. The number was slightly lower in the group with prophylaxis rather than no anticoagulation at all. This is actually a large, around 4,300 patients from Mount Sinai that was published around 2 weeks ago. So that's the... So essentially, 0.5 to 5% based on the severity. In the milder groups, it is less. And in the critically ill groups, it is more.
So you're saying generally the risk of bleeding is low, particularly if you use low molecular weight heparin, and it in comparison to the risk of the condition in critically ill patients, the mortality is upward of 50%. The risk of bleeding is relatively low.
The benefits far outweigh the risks.
Thank you for making that point. The other questions about kg body weight dosing. When we're dealing with obese patients, should we calculate it based on their current weight or the ideal weight? Is there a thing? And in prophylaxis, would you recommend kg body weight dosing or just the standard dosing? Bala, any comments?
In people with normal body weight, you need not calculate according to the body weight. 40 milligram enoxaparin equivalent is enough. But obesity itself is a risk factor for thrombosis. So that's the one more reason why in obese individuals we need to calculate according to their actual body weight. So if their body weight is more than 80 kilograms, then it is better that we calculate according to their actual body weight, and so that the effectiveness is maintained.
So calculate your doses according to the current weight rather than the ideal weight.
Yes.
And I think the rule is simple. Sushil, any comments?
No, sir. Essentially the same thing. Actually, in our ICU, we found that this standard dose of 60 mg twice a day, lots of the patients did not achieve the factor 10A levels. And they were a big thing was that it was not weight-based. So the intervention to them not achieving the factor 10A level target was to make it a weight-based dosing, after which most of them achieved their target.
Prophylaxis, what do you suggest?
So prophylaxis doesn't need weight-based is what the guidelines all suggest. Standard doses which I just mentioned would be enough.
So in therapeutic, prefer a kg body weight, but prophylactic, use a standard dose. So the couple more questions. If an elderly patient who's already on warfarin for AF, would you advise to continue warfarin when that patient develops COVID, or would you rather change to a different anticoagulant? So I think it's saying that should you change to heparin or continue on warfarin? And the answer may be different depending on the symptom category.
Severity of illness.
Yeah, severity. Do you want to comment, Paula?
Yeah, so the warfarin is affected in a lot of ways. The absorption and the pharmacokinetics gets affected when the patient is critically ill. So if the patient is critically ill and in the severe category, better that we change warfarin to heparin, because we can assure that the adequate amount of anticoagulation is being achieved, which may not be possible with warfarin.
So one of the patients that was presented from Medicine One was a lady who already had pulmonary embolism before coming and had a INR which was about 5 when she presented with severe critical COVID, was intubated, so we actually could not anticoagulate her. And then when the PTNR came down, we started on low molecular weight heparin and then shifted back to warfarin, but she still clotted, which was the case. Any comments, Sushil, on the issue of transitioning from oral anticoagulants to heparin? Yeah. So, Sushil, are you able to hear us?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I'll just put this last question to you. Is there any association with blood group and thromboembolic phenomena? Are you aware of anything which is there?
Sir, there are many hypotheses right now, but I don't think there are 3-4 publications on the O blood group, but I don't think that we should, there's no prospective data on that at all. There's some retrospective data that the O blood group has, but the O blood group are less likely to test positive was another confounder, but there is nothing on anticoagulation that any society guideline has recommended for any particular blood group.
So I think we're coming to the end of our questions. I would like to summarize some points that have come out from all of today's presentations. This is an emerging area which we don't yet have full knowledge. It is clear that there is an increased risk of venous thrombosis and probably arterial thrombosis associated with COVID-19. D-dimer is a marker of severity, but not a marker of thrombosis. There are lack of sufficient evidence based on RCTs to guide clinical practice. However, we know that patients who are sick have high risk of dying. And in critically ill patients, the rates of pulmonary embolism are significant. So there is general consensus that in moderate and severe and critical patients, we should give thromboprophylaxis. The confusion is regarding who to give therapeutic anticoagulation, and there is a difference of opinion from a conservative school, which says that give therapeutic anticoagulation only in patients where you suspect pulmonary embolism, to the other school, which advocates it in critically ill patients or severe patients with risk factors. In CMC, what we have seen is that the audit and the survey seem to suggest that people are favoring a more liberal approach, as Bala put it, for therapeutic anticoagulation. We also know that the role of prophylaxis at discharge is not clear. However, use of aspirin in people with risk factors may be a safe approach. So I'd like to really thank Dr. Bala for taking on the challenge today and summarizing all the evidence to us. And for all our Anna, for the survey, and all our postgraduate students for their different presentations and summarizing the experience. Thank you all for joining today's session. Next week's session is on COVID-19 and ICU care, which will be delivered by Dr. Binila Chako, Professor of Critical Care in CMC. And we look forward to having you again with us. Please invite your friends and others whom you know are involved in COVID care to our session, and we have a couple more slotted. The one following that is on communication in COVID-19 and issues of end-of-life care and death and dying following the next week's session. Next week will be also on Thursday, September 24th, 4 to 5 p.m. We'll send out the link, and I'll hand over now to Dr. Thomas Ram to conclude today's session.
Thank you, friends, for participating in this third lecture. And we hope that it was useful for all of you. And it was good to see that there were so many queries and clarifications coming up on the chat box. And I hope that some of them have been answered. At this point, I'd like to again thank our resource faculty from CMC, Dr. Bala Mugesh, for that sharing of his experience and the evidence, what is available. Dr. Anand Zakaria for moderating this session, and all the presenters, and also our team who's been working behind the scenes, the staff training department and the telemedicine department. So I'd like to thank you once more. And a reminder again to all of you that next week, same time, we have a session on ICU care and COVID-19 patients. And as I left a link on the chat box, that if you like to have the video recording of the session, you may please email to ccc.training at cmcvello.ac.in. So thank you once more. Have a good evening. Have a safe evening. God bless you.